This RealAg Radio podcast is brought to you by new Intruvix 2 herbicide from FMC. New Intruvix 2 herbicide is an all-in-one formulation that gives you the best of both worlds, fast-burning activity and long-lasting systemic action for more consistent broadleaf control pre-seed to cereals. See your local retailer today.
It's time for Real Ag Radio on Rural Radio Channel 147 on Sirius XM. RealAg Radio and RealAgriculture.com is your home for insight and analysis of the issues that are impacting your farm business. Let's get real and get connected with RealAg Radio. Welcome to RealAg Radio here on Rural Radio 147, Sirius XM. Shaun Haney, your host here on this Wednesday edition of the show. Thanks so much for making RealAg Radio and Rural Radio 147 a big part of your workday. Also, a big shout out to everybody listening out there on the RealAg Radio podcast. We have a great show for you here today. So yesterday we were with the Northern Pulse Growers out of Minot, North Dakota. Today we're in Winnipeg, Manitoba, and we're at the Keystone Agricultural Producer Meeting, KAP. We're at their annual general meeting. This is a general farm organization in Manitoba. We have a very, very packed house here. You heard all the applause. We're between them and the beer. So that's maybe a reason why they're applauding. We're getting a little closer to the reception time and the banquet. But they've had a great full day here, and it's great to finish off the day with them here this afternoon. Today on the show, we're going to be doing a producer panel. We've got Harley Siemens, Kevin Peters, and Carter McKinney is going to be with us. We're going to dive into, you know, what are some of the big things that are impacting their farms right now on a daily basis? What would they like to change in the industry? And why are they here? They've taken some time to spend time at the KAP meeting. I'd like to know a little bit deeper into why they are participating in an event like this. We're also going to be talking to Brenna Mahoney. She's the executive director with KAP. And we'll talk to her about the organization because this is actually a big celebration point. It is the 40-year anniversary of KAP, which is really, really cool. So that's kind of a big number and really, really important that we also celebrate some of the wins as well as they're representing farmers across the province, across all the different, you know, livestock and crop genres. If you have any feedback on today's show, you can provide me, or you can send me an email, I should say, shaney@realagriculture.com. You can also find us across all the different social media platforms. You're also welcome to call the RealAg feedback line. The number is 855-776-6147. You dial that number, you press the number 3, and you leave me a message. You know, it's really interesting. I think we're kind of in meeting season of the agricultural cycle. You know, farmers and ranchers getting together really, you know, on a weekly basis. As you've been hearing on this show, there's a meeting every day that is happening. And I don't care which meeting it is, it's this one or other ones. It's really an opportunity for farmers to rub together, so to speak, share ideas, talk about important topics that are impacting the industry, because there's no shortage of them. There's a lot of variables being thrown at our industry every single day. It impacts margins, it impacts our profits, it impacts our livelihoods, even in some cases some of our legacies when it comes to some of the farm succession issues and taxation. And really, some of that policy work and that advocacy work, that lobbying work, it really starts in rooms just like this one here, where we're together in this room at the KAP meeting. Okay? This is important stuff. And of course, there's a social setting. That's a whole other part of it. You know, getting together and having a pint or maybe a glass of water or whatever your flavor is to talk about your farms, what you're going through. There's that social connection, which is also a critical part of meetings like today. There's going to be, you know, discussions and maybe even arguments about, you know, do we need to change? Why do we need to change? I like how it was. I like how it could be. That's all a part of the industry evolving. Keep an open mind, right? I've heard that there's, you know, been talks today about a number of different issues. Some of them, you know, probably you agreed with. Some of them you're probably like, I don't know about that. I could do without that. That's all a part of keeping curious, which I think is a very, very important word, and participating in days like today. So congratulations for being here. Appreciate that you've welcomed RealAg Radio into your meeting, and really looking forward to today's discussion. So let's take a break. And when we come back, we're going to bring up Brenna Mahoney, the executive director with KAP. We're going to put her on the spot, ask her some tough questions, and we'll continue on with the show. You're listening to RealAg Radio here on Rural Radio 147, Sirius XM.
It is time for today's product spotlight. So joining me, your host, Lindsay Smith, is Paul Sinkovich. He's with Vantage Ag. Vantage Ag markets themselves as the foliar experts, so let us know why.
Well, Lindsay, our new sub-nano liquid fertilizer products are specifically designed to be applied in a foliar application. They're really easy to use. You mix them with your pesticides. You can apply quickly and efficiently through your sprayer. It really couldn't be any easier. We totally bypass the soil ecosystem, which eliminates many of the factors that can influence fertilizer efficiency. And so this new technology, we feel, is changing how growers actually think about their fertility strategies with an unheard-of efficiency and ROI. It just makes sense.
All right. And for those who want more information about Vantage Ag, where can they go?
They can go to vantage.ag. They can also call us at Vantage Ag at 778-919-3370.
There's power, and then there's superpower. Advancing the unstoppable superpower of Pre-Seed from New Farm. Take control. Eliminate weed competition and start clean in spring. Manage weeds early in canola, cereals, and pulses. Conquer, Goldwing, Thunderhawk, and Blackhawk EVO. Convenient formulations and multiple modes of action. Add more power to glyphosate. More benefits to your burndown. Go to newfarm.ca/burndown.
Oh, and welcome back to RealAg Radio here on Rural Radio 147 at Sirius XM. Of course, we're at the KAP meeting here in Winnipeg at the beautiful Delta Hotel. Fantastic location. Really looking forward to the banquet tonight. It's going to be a great time. As I mentioned, really, really packed house here. Really energetic crowd. Now we're going to be talking to the executive director with KAP. It is Brenna Mahoney. Brenna, how are you doing?
Just wonderful. Couldn't be better. It's a balmy, I think, -7 right now.
Thank goodness we weren't here last week. You were, but I wasn't.
I was absolutely here in Brandon for Ag Days, so it was like -50 almost.
Yeah, that's where our U.S. audience is like minus... Ooh, that's where like Celsius, Fahrenheit at -40 kind of connect.
It's just cold. That's all they need to know.
It is very, very cold. So it actually is a lot nicer this week, a little bit more tolerable, we should say. But I would say if you think of the Western Canadian prairies, we're in need of some more moisture. Hey, like it's drive-bys.
You know, I think that's when you talked about resiliency earlier. You know, our farmers that are sitting here in this room and across the province, they know a thing or two about being resilient. And we've seen just examples over the past year of the droughts, the floods, regional droughts and floods. It's not going away. And so that moisture that we are getting and the snow that we had even yesterday, all that little bit helps in the dry conditions that we've had.
Yeah, definitely some cheerleading for that, you know, early spring, I should say, that kind of, you know, that wet snow would really, really give us an opportunity to have a good start, launch out of the ground, and 2024 can be that year that we really, really do imagine. So let's talk about KAP. Now, everybody in this room is very familiar with KAP, but we got an audience listening across North America. Introduce everybody to who KAP is and what you do.
So Keystone Agricultural Producers has been around for 40 years. We're celebrating our 40th today, actually. So we're launching into our 2024 year. We're a general farm lobby association here in the province of Manitoba, representing all Manitoba farmers on issues that matter to them the most. I think that we have members of the audience actually that are here today, and even some of your listeners, Sean, that, you know, their local association that works on issues, they'll say, you know what, they've been around for a long time. There's been a lot of issues. We keep on reflecting as an organization on, hey, you know, remember when we had inflationary issues? Well, they're back. These things keep on coming back. So that's why organizations like KAP need to continue to be around and need to continue to be valuable, because we keep on having new issues and also the old issues keep on coming back, and we need to be relevant as an organization to help solve those.
Yeah, and I think, you know, there are things that come back, but there are new things that come on the front too. And there is kind of a difference, I think, too, when we think about issues we're trying to lobby on. There's like the reactive scenario, and then there's the importance of being proactive. And that's where we probably could spend more time as industry groups in this country.
Absolutely. I think, you know, a really good description that I had of it a few years ago when I first started working in the industry is our job is to be predictive of the waves that change the shoreline. And what that message was really about is, you know, there's a lot of waves that come, but what's actually going to change our landscape? And that's our job as Keystone Agricultural Producers is to help be predictive of what those issues are going to be and be prepared and preparing our producers around Manitoba for what that looks like. And that really does take that foresight and also that knowledge transfer. When I look around even my board table or the people around this room today, there's so much knowledge and experience here. So we are responsible to gather that information and bring it together to solve those problems and actually to say, hey, I'm starting to see these signals. What is that going to mean for me and my business? So we have to be connecting those dots as an organization and be ready to connect those dots to help solve those problems.
Yeah, and I think, you know, whether it's CAP or it's other organizations, you know, lobbying and advocacy has changed where, you know, I think at one time, you know, when agriculture maybe was a little bit, you know, more viewed maybe in a different light, like we weren't 2% of the population, you know, we could show up in Ottawa or we could show up at the legislature provincially once a year, have a quick little meeting, maybe drink a little scotch and have supper and hey, we were done for the year. And that really, it's changed and it requires dollars and it requires time and it's volume and it's talking to a wider scope. You know, agriculture doesn't just talk to the ag minister anymore, say provincially, it's talking to numerous portfolios because transportation touches ag, healthcare touches ag, infrastructure touches ag. It's really environment, you know, it's very multilateral.
It takes communication, collaboration, and that really that working together as that single voice, which is a part of our message. You know, when we look at the mosaic of the industry that we're in, and I mean your listeners here, whether they be, you know, down in Texas or in the East Coast of Canada, they can all relate to there's a lot of people working in agriculture on their behalf, associations like ours, their commodity groups. So how do we all work together in this advocacy space to make sure that we're actually being collaborative and being solutions oriented? Because that can be an absolute challenge to get the message across to the people who are making decisions.
Okay, so let's talk about some of the issues that you've been working on. What's been going on this past year? What are some of the things you're working on?
Well, I think, we started off by talking about, I think, weather challenges and making sure our producers have access to protection measures for funding when there are losses or when there are issues like floods and droughts. I think that's been a critical part of our past couple years, actually. Also, Bill C-234, which we heard about from a panel earlier today on the carbon tax. Again, actually a really good example of how we're collaborating as an industry through the Ag Carbon Alliance to make sure information is being directed clearly and effectively on that issue. When we look at other local issues here at home, you know, the transportation issues and challenges with the port strikes, making sure farmers are able to get their product to port and off to market has been essential over the past year. Labor. We talk a lot about labor and ag, and I don't care what corner of the industry you're in, labor is a huge challenge. And as an organization, we have tackled that in an incredibly collaborative way. We have actually a task force dedicated just to labor, and we even work directly on veterinary challenges. And that's coordinating not only with the academics who are actually teaching the students these skills, but also making sure we're hearing from producers, commodity groups, government, and other influencers to that labor space. And we're starting to see results of that. There are a lot of issues, Shaun, and we could spend all day, we could hours talking about all the challenges that we've had. But I think an important message to get across about what's happened over the past year with CAP is the board has been working on a new strategic plan to position us to be able to deal with the advocacy issues that we're having, to make sure that we're doing the right engagement and outreach with not only members, but the public, government, decision makers, and also making sure that we're aware of what's the regulatory modernization environment, that it's a moving target. And if we're not ready as an organization to deal with that, it doesn't matter what issue comes or what issues are currently going on, we're not going to be able to be successful in resolving them.
It was interesting. You mentioned labor. over the weekend and beginning of the week, the American Farm Bureau was holding their annual meeting in the U.S., and President of American Farm Bureau, Zippy Duvall, said the number one threat to the agricultural industry was labor and the shortage of it. And it's not the situation is actually getting worse, not better. And there's obviously multiple streams of solutions to it. You know, you could say robotics, or you could say importation of labor. It's really going to take I think there's just not one silver bullet to fix it. It's going to really, really take a lot of different avenues to make it happen. So when you look at all those issues, what are some of the things the organization is doing to deal with those things?
I think that collaborative spirit is key. So we talk about support coalitions on issues. We've already talked about Bill C-234 and the Ag Carbon Alliance. We need to be a part of those conversations. On the labor task group, that is not just CAP alone. We are working with other key partners to come up with single solutions on those challenges. That's critical to our success. We talked about the mosaic. There's so many organizations in our industry. So trying to coordinate those individual groups and the individual members that they're representing is a huge part of our challenge. So I think that's one of the step ingredients, is that collaboration and that coordination that's going to be necessary. I think as an organization as well, is making sure we're building positive relationships. Relationships matter. And, you know, you can go into a meeting and you can share a value with somebody, but where does it go from there? And how do you continue that conversation? Well, that comes through the relationships. So we've been talking for a number of years now as an organization about relationships matter, and that's critical to our industry. And we heard Maddie here with Ag with Maddie was on our panel today talking about how agriculture matters to everyone. And I think that when we look at, you know, how do we make sure that ultimately not only this future generation understands that what agriculture plays a role in, but the people actually in our industry are working and collaborating together, we're not going to be able to solve the problems. We need the new generation to be part of the conversation. We need the people in it to make sure that they're coordinating and building that relationship and ultimately the trust to solve problems.
That Maddie's pretty good.
She's amazing. I was starstruck, I'll tell you that much. She should still be up here.
I better enjoy my job while it lasts.
A collective.
You know, I got a bunch of questions for the panel. And one of them is what got you into the ag industry? So as we wrap up here, because you're actually a case of what we're going to have to do more of. You didn't necessarily grow up in the industry. We adopted you.
You did adopt me, Sean, and Sean was there right from the very beginning. It's really interesting. I don't come from agriculture. I do not come from a farm. I was on a three-month term with an organization called Cereals Canada, and I was there in an administrative role, and I absolutely fell in love with the industry immediately. And I went to my boss at the time, Cam Dahl, who's a regular on your show, and I just said, how do I stay in this business? And I applied for a role in the organization. I became the director of communications and stakeholder relations. And there hasn't been a day that I have not worked in this industry, even if it's been tough, that I have ever thought I wanted to work anywhere else. And that's really when we talked about the labor issue that you just were bringing up. What's the solution to that? Is that we need to build a pathway for the future people like me. There's going to be a lot of organizations and even producers, people part of our primary ag industry that are not going to know what you know. And so we need to be bringing them in. The passion I have is shared. It's more than just a job. It's a lifestyle and it's a choice. And it's something that I want to make sure that as not only myself, but the organization that I'm leading, that we're part of that future and sharing that passion with others.
Well, we're a fun group, us people in ag.
Yeah, we're definitely fun.
We like to
especially
fun.
When there's beer involved that everyone's waiting for.
We'll show you tonight. We're a great time. Brenna, thanks a lot for having us here. I really do appreciate it. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much, Sean.
Okay, we're going to take a break. When we come back, we're going to bring up our farmer panel. We got a whole bunch of issues to talk about. We'll be right back. You're listening to Real Ag Radio, Rural Radio 147.
Co-op knows your community because we live here too. Our teams are your trusted partners with a range of expertise to help support your entire farm operation. And we're giving back. In the past 5 years, Co-op has invested over $1.1 billion in the prairies through building, upgrading, and expanding local facilities. And we've returned over $1.17 billion to Co-op members in the prairies. Co-op, we're all building something for the future. Here for your farm, here for your family. Learn more at co-op.crs. truvix.com/farm.
When you see how fast Intruvix 2 herbicide from FMC smacks down narrow-leaved hawksbeard, volunteer canola, kochia, and those other problem weeds, you'll be saying, stronger and faster? Shut the front door. Apply it with glyphosate before planting cereals, and you'll enjoy cleaner fields faster while protecting your future glyphosate use. Cheese and crackers. Just how easy can you get? Intruvix 2 herbicide from FMC. Clean is good. See your local retailer.
FP Genetics relentlessly brings innovative new seed genetics to Canadian farms, ensuring growers, breeders, and farmers are supported and viable. Being a valued partner on your farm for decades, you can expect the continuous pursuit of the best genetics. Visit fpgenetics.ca to discover FP's strong portfolio of wheat, durum, barley, oats, peas, and rye, or contact your local FP seed dealer or territory manager to discuss your certified seed strategy specific to your region.
And welcome back to Real Ag Radio here on Rural Radio 147 at Sirius XM. We are bringing the KAP meeting, the AGM for the Keystone Ag Producers, here from Winnipeg, Manitoba, to everybody really across Canada and the U.S. We're talking about a lot of issues that the organization is dealing with, and really, quite frankly, whether you're in Manitoba, you're in Montana, you're in Florida, or you're in PEI, a lot of these issues are really, in general, impacting farmers across a pretty broad region. Now, there can be specific issues to a province like Manitoba, and I'm sure some of those will probably come up here as well today. So we've got three young farmers. Well, we'll say young. You guys like that? Young?
That works.
That's a good description, exactly. Okay, so we got three farmers here from Manitoba. So they are of local quality. Talk about some of the issues that are impacting their operations. So let's get into it and hear a little bit about them, and then we'll dig into some of the issues. So up first, we've got Harley Siemens. Harley, nice to meet you.
Yeah, thanks for having me on here. My name's Harley Siemens. I live in Rosenart, Manitoba, which is a small town just south of Winnipeg. I'm a layer farmer as well as a pullet farmer. So we are in the business of creating eggs and making eggs and bringing them to consumers here in Manitoba and across Canada. I also have barns located in Niverville, Manitoba, and Blumenort.
Oh, wow. Cool. So, sorry, you say, what was the second one?
Pullet farmer.
What, okay, I'm outside of the poultry. What is that?
So a pullet farmer is a farmer that is going to raise a day-old chick to 19 weeks old, because at 19 weeks is when the chicken's going to start laying eggs. So for that time, they call it a pullet.
Okay, and then you ship it to...
Yeah, and then we'll move to the next barns, which will be a laying hen barn.
Okay. My colleague Calvin Heppner has a laying barn, I think.
Oh, good friends with Calvin.
Okay, from Altona. There you go. Awesome. Okay. Okay, now we're experts in poultry. Also, Johnny. So, Harley, who else do you farm with? Your family or?
Yeah, so I farm with my dad. In the last couple of years, I've since taken over majority of the farms and different things like that. So we still have a really good working relationship. Got a bunch of employees that employ all the farms and kind of manage it. And then I can oversee the operations and still have to go and fix manure belts on minus 45 days. So it's still good to be the boss in that way.
Yeah. Well, interesting. That's good stuff. Well, welcome. I really appreciate you doing this. Also joining us is Kevin Peters. Kevin, tell us about your farm.
My name's Kevin Peters. Live near Randolph, Manitoba, just southeastern Manitoba. Third generation hogs and grain farmer. Farm together with my family. There's a handful of us. We got myself, my brother, and our dad. I got an uncle, his son, my cousin, and got a fourth generation coming in soon here. So,
With all those family members, the stories that you could tell.
It has its days.
Yeah, but,
we make it work, and it works well together. So
that's awesome. And I also appreciate you being honest. Like anybody that works in a family business, and listen, I think, what is it? The number's like 98% of the farms are family businesses. There are great days, there are rewarding days, and then there are days like, what the heck are we doing, right? But it's adversity, sure. And you get through it. You just got to manage it, right? Conflicts, iron sharpens iron. It conflicts all a part of it.
You really got to run it as a business and sort of leave the relationship part to the side at times and just focus on the business.
Yeah, that, and when there it, when it's personal time, it's personal time. Like I had a farmer one time tell me there was three families that were of cousins that were working together, and they really set like clear guidelines and rules. Like so, when they got together after church on Sunday, that was not time to talk about where the margins were. That was for Monday morning, and it could be hard to be disciplined in doing that, having that those kind of boundaries, right? Or do you just hey, when we get together, we talk business. Everybody's different.
We're pretty free. We talk about everything personal and work.
Yep. But
definitely when it's business, it's focus on business. So,
do each of you have specific responsibilities that you take care of?
Yeah, we each sort of, I'll say specialize in, yep. in roles. My cousin does a lot of the books and I take care of the shop and my brother does a lot of shop work and trucking on the for the farm as well. So.
Oh, awesome stuff. Well, welcome. Also joining us is Carter McKinney. So Carter, tell us about your farm.
Hi, thanks, Sean. It's really good to be on the show. I listen to your show regularly, and it's going to be weird hearing myself next time I listen.
So. I encourage you just, yeah. The main thing I hear from a lot of people is, that's not how I sound in my head.
Yeah, I'm going to keep that in mind for sure. But I farm in the southwest corner of Manitoba, near Waskada, Manitoba. Yeah. Nobody's ever heard where that is, but you can look it up. I farm grains, oil seeds, and pulses with my dad and mom and my fiance, and her parents also come out and help during the busy season for us. And fun fact, we have a old wooden Manitoba pool grain elevator that's over 100 years old that we still service and use regularly. So
wow.
That's kind of our fun little claim to fame.
So was it the local elevator you bought it and you use it? Or?
Yeah, it was the Delny elevator, and it was up for private sale when Manitoba Pool divested a bunch of assets. And we bought it because it was literally in our land. So
oh, really?
It serves us well still.
Did you put the farm logo on the side of it?
No, we kept the Manitoba pool for nostalgia.
Oh, that's really cool. Yeah. Let's see. It, you know, those elevators were such a, like, just a huge part of our landscape. Like, every town you went into, right, you'd one or three or maybe more of them, depending on where you were. You know, the different colors, and there's been so many paintings and photographs. They're so iconic. It is too bad that so many of them have either burnt down or they've been torn down. Like, it's too bad more of them haven't survived, I think.
Yeah, it is unfortunate, but they do end up taking a lot of your time, and it's a big investment to keep them up. We have done a lot of major investments, including new roofs and recribbing the sides of it, and we're looking at re-siding it in the future potentially here. But it's a large financial investment, but without it for our particular operation, it would be a big loss if it was to burn down or something else.
Yeah, well, I think you know, hearing the backgrounds on the farms that you guys are representing up here on the stage, it's a good example of the wide range of interests that, you know, a general farm organization like CAP represents. So really appreciate you guys stepping up and being here. What we're going to do is we're going to take a quick break, and then we're going to dive into some of the issues and talk about that and find out what's on your mind. So we'll be right back. You're listening to Real Ag Radio. We're broadcasting from the CAP AGM in Winnipeg, Manitoba, and we'll be right back right after this.
Does your N stabilizer contain an active ingredient load high enough to be agronomically effective? If not, it could be costing you time and money. If you're putting down a nitrogen stabilizer, put your trust in Koch Agronomic Services. Solutions like SuperU, Tribune, and Anvil. Each delivers high active ingredient concentrations that low-rate products just can't match. Compare how imitator products stack up to agronomically effective solutions at defendyourn.ca. Whether you're in a career within an organization, starting your own business, looking for your dream job, running your own farming operation, operating a company in ag or food, or want to hone your overall life skills, this conference is for you. Celebrating over 10 years of bringing women in ag together, join the Advancing Women Conference in Calgary on March 17th, 18th, and 19th. Visit advancingwomenconference.ca for more information and to register.
Don't get weak on me now. Welcome back to Real Ag Radio, Rural Radio 147, Sirius XM broadcasting from the KAP AGM here in Winnipeg, Manitoba. It is a much milder temperature this week, as we were talking with Brenna Mahoney from KAP. Thank goodness we weren't here last week. We are joined by Harley Siemens, Kevin Peters, Carter McKinney. Okay, guys, now that we've heard about your farms, let's dive into some things. I'm really interested, Harley, did you always know that you were coming back to the farm? Or did you have intentions to do something else and the industry just sort of sucked you back in?
Yeah, no, that's... I've always had intentions of being on the farm. The big draw for me is that it's something different every day, right? Mm. I know with my personality, I wasn't going to be an office job person. I knew that was not going to work out. And over time, I think us being teenagers and different things, we take for granted of growing up on a farm, right? You're like, you have your friends. They don't have to go on Saturday. They get to sleep in. They get to do what they want. Well, Saturday morning, we have to go to the barn. We have to go to work, right? And you can kind of build that disgruntledness up, right? So it was for a little bit there, I was like, I don't want that. I want to do something else. And then it started to turn, and I started to see all the positives in it and all those different things to reinvest. And, I could be my own boss. Today, I could be an electrician. The next day, I could be a plumber. Then this day, do this. So that really drew me in. And also, you get to provide food. You get to provide a staple in people's homes, and you get to be a part of that. That's an awesome thing to be a part of.
Yeah, you know, Sherilyn Nagel, who often appears on our show on Fridays on the Issues panel, she's from Mossbank, Saskatchewan, and I've heard Sherilyn say before that when she was growing up, she knew one thing. She didn't want to be on the farm. It was anything but the farm. But just like you talked about, there's a point there where there's an opportunity for sort of a flip. Well, like, wait a minute. There's a lot of really cool things about making this my career, not my lifestyle, right? But it's a business, and there's a really cool, there's opportunity here. Kevin, how about you?
For me, it was what I always wanted to do, and it's what I do. And it went straight from high school. I went to university, did the ag diploma, ironically, almost 25 years ago.
It goes fast, doesn't it?
It goes really fast.
Really fast.
Really fast. But it's what I'm passionate about. It's what I love to do. I agree with Harley. It's ever changing. Day-to-day jobs are changing. The phone rings and you got to run here and do this. Sometimes, like you said, you're a plumber, you're an electrician. I love being a mechanic. My home is in the shop. I love working on stuff, fixing problems. That's what I love to do.
Yeah. I've always said that I think a lot of farmers are interested in raising livestock and agronomics. A lot of farmers are interested in problem solving and logistics. Yeah. That's a huge part of what happens on a daily basis as we go through the business cycle. Are those kinds of things. Carter, how about you?
Very much echoing what Harley said and Kevin. It's the different hats that you wear every day. Like I had tossed out a bunch of options coming out of high school, like what do I want to do, and ultimately decided I'd like the independence of being a farmer, because when you are in our position, you get to decide what you want to do on a daily basis, and there's obviously jobs that need to get done, but you're very much your own boss, and I don't think I could do the 9-to-5 under somebody else and have them telling me what I'm supposed to do every day. It's that independence factor is really what drew me in.
I once had a farmer on one of these panels. I asked that question, and they said, well, you know, they sort of said the independence thing like you did, but they went a bit further, like, I actually hate people. And so it was a way I could spend more time by myself. It's just like, okay.
I don't quite hate people. That's one thing that I actually really like about agriculture is the relationships that you can build from events like this with other farmers like Kevin and Harley and even yourself.
You have so much in common.
Yeah, there's always something to talk about, and you can really meet a lot of wonderful people like all the people here today.
Yeah, absolutely. So let's stick with you, Carter. What's an issue that is right now... You know, you're on the tractor, driving the pickup truck, you got some windshield time. What's an issue that comes to mind that is impacting your farm right now that takes up some mind time for you?
One of the issues that bothers and keeps me up at night is kind of the changing social environment and the social dynamic that agriculture has with the general public. Is there's a lot of people that are trying to change the way that everybody does things in the world right now, including the ag industry. And it's not necessarily from a good or bad place. It might be from a place of lack of knowledge or preference towards certain types of things, like, say, environmentalism, where ag needs to tackle these issues before they tackle us. And that's kind of something that keeps me awake at night.
Yeah. Kevin, do you identify with that one?
Yeah, no, that's a very real fear, I guess, is a concern that we feel like we're doing a service and providing food and doing the best we can. And I know there's always room for us to improve, but sometimes it feels like we just get pushed back by some of the social pressures, whether it's environmental is probably the biggest concern. You feel it in the animal industry. You feel it even in the agriculture crop industry.
Yeah. Well, you think about, what comes to mind right away is Proposition 12 in California, which is essentially new rules for the state of California. So any pork that shows up on the grocery store shelf has to have been raised by a certain standard that is actually above the federal standard. So it's, California produces very little of its own pork. And so they're importing from other states. They're also importing from Canada. And it's creating a lot of friction on the system based on some legislation that was passed in a state that tends to be quite activist in nature. Again, those maybe aren't even real from a farmer's perspective, not really even benefiting the care of the animal. It's just it's a bunch of rules we put on a board.
Yeah, so the Prop 12 issue is very real, and I'm going to be completely honest. I'm on both sides of that Prop 12. We're involved in some barn sites where we've made the renovations, and we are actually capitalizing on the Prop 12.
With chaos comes opportunity.
It can, and it's I see both sides. I'm not all about the legislation either. But when you see opportunity, sometimes you got to go for it.
Well, especially if there's going to be resistance to people changing, because there's an investment, right, that you've had to make in
for
order
sure.
to meet those standards, right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Barn expansions.
Yeah. So some people are going to say, well, I ain't doing that because I'm hoping they're going to change the rule or the Supreme Court's going to turn it down or whatever. And so there's a barrier there. And so if you see an opportunity, you can jump on it. And there is, like you said, there are operations that are doing that. Okay, so Harley, what about you?
What keeps me up at night?
Yeah.
For me, I look at my kids. I know I'm only 28 years old, but I am fortunate enough to have three kids, and I want to be able to leave the
agriculture. How old are you?
28.
Oh, I thought you said you're 20 and have three kids. I'm like,
no,
whoa!
No. 28.
Wow, we got to talk.
But yeah, I want to leave the agriculture industry better off for my three kids. They're young, but what you've heard about all day today is future, 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 right? Who are we setting up to take over? What's that going to look like? And we know that food is here to stay. We need food to live, right?
Mm-hmm.
And we want to make sure that the people that are eating our food are trusting where it comes from, right? And when you can build that trust, that relationship, we are far better off. Line that I like to say is, you hear the line, farmers feed the world, but we also need those people as well. So that's a relationship that we got to work on together. And if I can help build that relationship, sharing stories about my farm, that's just helping my next generation. I want to see my kids be able to take over the farm and live how I've been able to live my first 28 years, right? And see the prosperity growth and then their kids and their kids.
That's pretty awesome. That's pretty good. Kevin, sorry, I skipped over it. What's the issue that is impacting your operation that we kind of skipped over you? I'm sorry.
I'm going to throw out carbon tax as a hot topic. For
me. Everybody drink!
Pretty much. After this last fall's harvest, it's big on my mind. Just got our last gas bill for, fortunate enough, we
can
have
you,
natural
Can you
gas.
Tell us, like, talk I'll, about the cost.
I'm going to tell you round numbers.
Yep.
Our bill was, I'll say, around $18,000.
$18,000.
Total. 10,000 was gas, 3,000-ish taxes and fees, 5,000 is carbon tax.
That is insane.
That will keep you up at night.
Yeah. Oh, insert Sean rant. And what I don't understand is the fact that the heating of barns in 234 became the contentious part of the discussion in the Senate. Are there other options besides propane and natural gas to heat those barns?
Well, yes, there's always other options. But
what does that look like?
Probably expensive.
You couldn't do it with solar.
No. Usually you're going to need funding, some kind of programming to do a biomass furnace or some way of utilizing something else we have on our crop side to offset heating costs. I don't have all the answers. I really don't.
Yeah. Talk about the carbon tax from your perspective.
Yeah, the carbon tax in the poultry industry is horrible, and it really, really hurts our bottom line. Same thing as Kevin here. But for us, I look at some of the alternatives, and I look at the alternatives, and I said, well, somebody's going to have to pay for that. So in our system, there's a cost production. So my cost production shoots through the roof. Well, now we're just making our eggs are going to have to be more expensive, and then it just goes around and around. So we're not solving any problem. We're just pushing it. We're kicking it down the road. And that's not the right way to go about it. We want to be do we want to be conscientious of our environment? 100%. That's why we have high efficiency boilers, different things like that, to try and minimize our use. But that doesn't mean spending $700,000 to heat a small barn where I can have one gas boiler.
Yeah, and I think I saw this morning in BC, they are trying to raise the price of poultry in the province, and now there's a pushback from some of the grocers saying this isn't the right time, just
exactly.
Like we saw it in the discussion of the dairy situation. Supply management, I guess, has that opportunity based on the price the marketing model. Mm-hmm. Pork doesn't. Like there is no system for you to do that. That you're incurring that cost, and that's it.
Yeah.
Yeah, makes no sense. I just pull the string, get Sean going. Okay, we're going to take a break. We've got one more segment coming up here on Real Ag Radio at the KAP meeting in Winnipeg. We'll be right back. You're listening to Real Ag Radio, Rural Radio 147.
Through a growing storm of kochia, cleavers, chickweed, and more, there's a clear path. Introducing Oxbow, a versatile cereal broadleaf herbicide that gets the job done. Powered by Duplisan technology, Oxbow is your workhorse on resistant kochia and other tough weeds. With flexibility in timing, rates, and recropping options, your path is clear. Find your way on the path of least resistance at newfarm.ca/oxbow.
What's next for your fields? At Pioneer, delivering industry-leading genetics drives everything we do. From the scientists in the lab to our local teams with boots on the ground, we are determined to get there first. Developing top-performing products, proven in more growing conditions than ever before. Pioneer. What's next happens here. Visit pioneer.com/Canada to learn more.
And welcome back to Real Ag Radio here on Rural Radio 147, Sirius XM, broadcasting from the KAP AGM in Winnipeg, Manitoba. We've got a great farmer panel here today. Harley Siemens, Kevin Peters, and Carter McKinney. Okay, so we talked about the issues that comes to mind in terms of keeping you up at night. I'm curious, is there anything that annoys you about our sector or you wish we would do less of? Like, we're not perfect. We could have, no, we're not. No industry, nobody's, no person is perfect and no industry is perfect. So what is something that you wish we would do less of? Harley, you first.
I think, and we're doing it here, but we're all on the same team. You see the sign behind me here, we have cattle, then we have the grains, we have the poultry, and we have the hogs, right? Mm-hmm. The swine, and all the different. And I think one thing that really hurts me to see is when other commodity groups go against other commodity groups. And the public just loves that, right? Because they're seeing, oh, they can't even figure it out. And that's one thing that I think we need to learn how to work together and provide a unified, strong front. That's why CAP's here. CAP's here for us to come together, sort our issues in these rooms, and come together as a unified front, not for us out in the public to go and pin ourselves against each other. We're all here to provide good food, so let's do that together.
Yeah, and that on some issues, that's really easy. Rural broadband. There is not a commodity that will be against improving rural broadband. Or maybe it's municipal or county taxation issues. There's one that's really, really easy for everybody to get wrapped around. But there are issues where naturally, because groups are on different sides of the transaction, they're going to be opposed to each other, but it's finding the common ground. Too many times in agriculture, we focus on like the 5 or 10% that we disagree on, yep, instead of thinking about what we actually agree on. Kevin, what do you think we do? What do you wish we did less of?
I'm going to throw, maybe it's going to be controversial, but the thank a farmer slogan I could do without personally. I think for me, it's just what I love to do, and I think anybody in any industry, if they love what they do, they don't really do it for the thanks. We do it because it's what we want to do and because we love to do it, and it's my job. And I'm passionate about it, but it's not like I need to be thanked.
Do you think we're looking for, when we ask for that, we're looking for sort of just relevant, like we're asking the general public to find us relevant?
I think probably some of the thought behind it is just to think about where your food came from, sort of that, you know, the old saying, you need a doctor once a month or once a year, but you need a farmer three times a day, that thought. And I think it comes from a good place. I don't know. It just, maybe it bugs me a bit. I don't know.
Well, I get what you're saying. Okay. Because you think about it, when you go to the gas pump and you fill up with fuel. When you fill up a fuel, do you say, oh, thank an oil worker? Right? We don't.
We don't.
We don't. Yeah, so I get what you mean about that. Carter, what about you?
For me, I think back a little bit because I don't like the amount of centralization that we're doing. And we can talk about it with healthcare and a lot of things in Manitoba with perimeteritis. But for me, being in the corner of the world that I am, it's a long haul to go anywhere to do anything. We're very fortunate that for us, it's only 20 minutes to one dealership. But if we were to, say, try and get something else from a different dealership, it's 45 minutes, an hour, and I know other people, like a friend in Lac de Bonnie, he has to drive to Winnipeg to get parts for his CAT tractor. So that's one thing that I wish that our sector would do, is bring things a little bit back to the small town again, like it used to be dozens and dozens of years ago.
Yeah, when Real Agri Studies asked farmers about, which is the market research arm of Real Agriculture, we asked farmers, you know, are you concerned about consolidation? And it was something like 90% of farmers were concerned about consolidation. Actually, and if I remember correctly, it was the equipment sector, equipment dealers, where there was the most concern about consolidation for, you know, things like what you just described. You know, Kevin, getting back to what you said about thanking a farmer, another Shaun rant that I've said many times, I won't go into it, but you know what I wish we did in Canada more? Thank people that serve in the military. That's what I wish we did. We could replace the thank a farmer with thank your the military person.
Absolutely.
Yeah, anyway. Okay, easier maybe. What do you wish we did more of, Carter? What does our industry need to do more of?
On the theme of Ag Matters, it's advocate for ourselves. And really, we're doing it, but we need to keep doing it. We need to advocate for ourselves and get things like Ag in the Classroom moving forward and keep pushing them hard and get to the message of ag matters and our issues and things like that to the more urban populace. Like, there's a big disconnect that's happened over the generations between urban and rural, and that's right now, I think, is one of the biggest political and social issues that we have. Like, you just have to look down in the United States, there's a big urban-rural divide there as well, and Canada is urban-rural as well, and it's really dividing us as people and as humans, and we need to keep pushing to bridge that gap, and I think agriculture, because of the diversity of the sector and all the things that we can do, is a good avenue to start breaking down that divide and start unifying people together, because there's a lot of division these days and a lot of people get angry and there's a lot of hot topics, but we need to start breaking these things down and coming back together as people and forming better relationships with each other.
Well, a lot of times we phrase issues like agricultural issues versus urban, but or the consumer, but actually it's more rural urban on a lot of these fronts that are how I would break down a lot of these issues. Kevin, how about you?
Yeah, I think just to sort of build on what Carter was saying, I think it's small tidbits of information where we can share our story. You know, if it's at the supper table, if it's a bigger family gathering, you've got people that maybe aren't closely related to farm, so they don't have the same understanding of food and our processes, whether it's animal production or crop production or whatever it is. But I think it's small pieces of information. And I think it's important to attach a story and grasp emotion with
totally.
It. It's not just about stating facts and like, we're doing this the right way. It's the story behind it. It's tell why you're doing it.
Yep. Think about what happened during the pandemic. Think about like one of the top Netflix shows was the Drive to Survive, the F1 show. Why? Because it told stories and it created all these people are all of a sudden watching F1 racing that weren't before because all of a sudden they were connected to the stakeholders because they loved the stories.
They made them real.
They made them real, exactly. Harley?
Yeah, and to build off of them, it's also sharing the positive parts of the story. Yeah, we have to share the negatives and what's going on, but tell the good things about the story, right? Say that how you went in there today into the barn and all the birds were nice sounding and all the eggs that were getting produced and show, oh yeah, this egg is actually ending up on your table the next couple of days. And that came from a family farm. Oh, do you see, this is actually my daughter who's wanting to help, right? And showing that story, and when you, exactly like you said, when you build that connection, they invest in you, right? And you build that relation. And I think the more and more we do that, the better our industry is going to be. But it's not going to get fixed right away. It's going to take time, but I don't think that should slow us down or we should stop doing it. We got to keep on doing that, give more resources, share that story, because I'm guessing every time you guys bring a tour through your farms as well, there's never enough time. The amount of questions you ask. So just keep on opening that up. Go on YouTube channels, post to social media, show what you do. People really care.
Yeah, really good points. I really want to thank the three of you for participating today in the panel. Harley, Kevin, Carter, thanks so much. Thanks a lot, guys. Yeah, very well spoken. You really appreciate it.
Thanks, Sean.
Thanks for having us.
Thank you, Sean.
Okay, if you have any feedback on today's show, you can send me an email, shaney@realagriculture.com. You can also fire us a social media message across all the different social media platforms. At this point, there's too many to even point out. You can also call the Real Ag feedback line, 855-776-6147. A big shout out to KAP for having us here today at the AGM. Ooh, it's reception time. Looking forward to it. Thanks so much, everybody, for getting real and getting connected with Real Ag Radio. And we will, of course, chat again tomorrow.
Thank you for downloading this episode of the RealAg Radio podcast brought to you by new Intruvix 2 herbicide from FMC. New Intruvix 2 herbicide for cereals delivers outstanding control of the toughest broadleaf weeds like volunteer canola, narrow-leafed hogs beard, and kochia. See your local retailer for more information today.